you please pray? God, today as we celebrate, rejoice in all the goodness in our midst, may this time of worship be a pause, a moment to soak in all that you have given us. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, today we turned in our pledges, or will turn in, excuse me, our pledges and our promises. And perhaps some of you are not quite fully at peace yet with what you are going to put in the basket. Perhaps you're worried about whether you'll be able to live up to your promises to the church, or whether you'll still have enough for the rest of life. Today we also welcomed so many new and wonderful members into our midst. We welcomed them by forming a covenantal relationship with them. We stepped from welcome and casual friendship into the shared life of promise. And perhaps those of us who just made those promises and asked God to bless them, perhaps we wondered if we could really trust one another. Perhaps we wondered if our promises would stand the test of time or the storms of life. Or perhaps you came to worship this morning with a whole host of personal worries. Maybe it's family conflict or people you are really missing and grieving as we head into the holidays. Maybe it's debts that are mounting. Maybe it's the search for the job, for a job, or the keeping of a job. Maybe it's decisions about end-of-life care, end-of-life living arrangements. Maybe it's stress about what topics you'll talk about around the Thanksgiving table when all of your family gathers. Or maybe you have hanging heavy on you this morning some bigger global worry. Things like climate change, poverty, or homelessness. Things like terrorism, or religious extremism. Or the way our fears and our stereotypes and our generalizations are manifesting right now in barred doors for refugees who desperately need a safe haven, a place to welcome. Most of the time, we all come here to this place on Sunday morning with a lot of worries. A poem by Wendell Berry called Peace of Wild Things has been floating around online communities this week in the wake of the terror events. And it goes like this. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lay down where the woodrake rests, his beauty on the water and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things, who do not tax their life with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-long stars waiting with their light for a time, and I rest in the grace of the world, and I am free. I don't know when the last time was that you went and just sat among the wild things. I'm not sure when the last time was that you went and just rested in the grace of the world and the grace of our Creator. But when you do, I imagine you might discover, like Mr. Berry, an incredible peace, because wild things live so much of their lives present now. They know how to just be, how to live and move in the grace of this present moment. This week, as we celebrate and as we feast with family and with friends, we will remember how most of our families came to this country. country as refugees and as immigrants. And we will also remember how the native peoples of this land have, and still to this day, have an incredible connection with the soil and a great, great reverence for the living wild things of this earth. And I think we would be remiss in our celebrations of Thanksgiving if we did not learn from the Native Americans how to enter the life of gratitude by paying attention to that natural world. Jesus, in our gospel text this morning, points our attention to the lilies of the field and the birds. The psalmist points us to the soil and the pastures, to the animals and the fruit trees. You know, it's ironic, really, that our poetic psalmist instructs these wild things not to worry. Because, of course, most do not worry. But it has the intended effect on us, does it not? As if the soil would not trust God to bring new life and rich nutrients and water. And we think, oh, what are you even talking about to this psalmist? No, the soil simply soaks up whatever is there and blossoms and fruits into new life from whatever it has soaked up. But you know, even as we laugh that the wild things would be asked not to worry, we discover that we too, like the soil, like the lilies and the birds of the air, like the beasts and the trees, that we too can be patient and grateful, that we can be singing, flowering, dancing, fluttering, grace-filled recipients of the present now, soaking up all the goodness of God that we find right here, right now, in this present moment. When they have conducted personality studies, they have found that most humans spend the majority of their time dwelling in the past or dwelling in the future. Very few of us, it appears, can root ourselves right here in this present moment, something that comes so naturally for most of the natural world. So how do we live in the abundance of now, when we are so preoccupied with what has happened or what could happen? Well, I did a little reading this week about E. It's a good thing to do, getting ready for a week like we're about to have. And I came across an article in Harvard Health Blog. It was called, Why Eating Slowly May Help You Feel Full Faster. How interesting, I thought. You see, scientists have discovered that, like computers with those never-ending spirals and those progress bars that inch along, they've discovered that for us humans, it also takes time for our sense receptors in our stomach to send the message to our brains that there's something in there, that we've received something into our bodies. We are full, we are satisfied. It takes about 20 minutes time, they say, for our stomachs to fully communicate with our brains. And so, of course, I realize that there may be a few of you sitting out there getting this little science lesson thinking, okay, on Thursday I've got 20 minutes scrambling as much as I can. I've told you before that the Guarani people of Paraguay, or the native people of Paraguay, that they have a word for peace, guazu, and it means full or tranquil stomach. And I have to tell you, if you stuff as much as you can into yourself on those 20 minutes on Thursday, I guarantee you won't have a tranquil stomach. But I find it really interesting that in order to feel full, in order to feel satisfied, in order to feel that peaceful feeling in our bodies that we have enough, in order to know that we have received right now we are satisfied, but we are full. We have to pause. We have to let the message of that life-giving goodness we have received and taken in travel through us. We have to slow down. There's a common catchphrase these days, cultivating the attitude of gratitude. You might have heard it. It rings quite nice in English, doesn't it? But I want to propose that gratitude is not so much an attitude as a practice. It's a practice of pausing in life long enough to notice the here and now. Long enough to recognize that for the moment, we are full and we are satisfied. It's a spiritual practice of harmonizing our souls to the melody of the wild things, of rediscovering the earth creature inside us who lives each day in the grace of God. The Hebrew word for earth is Adamah. And of course, the first human creature that God creates is Adam, an earth creature, creature formed out of the earth. You know, our worry in so many ways is a product of our attempt to be gods, which of course we can't do. It's a product of our attempts, which are almost always futile, to be able to control the past or able to control the future. Gratitude, on the other hand, is a product of humility. It's a product of living as a creature, an earth creature, who can graciously receive what's happening right now. And I wonder if you take in life slowly enough that you receive that message that you are full. How slowly do you take in life? I wonder if you ground yourself as an earth creature in all the beauty and all the abundance that God fills you with and surrounds you with each and every day. I wonder if you are able to set aside the past and all of your grief about what has been lost. And I wonder if you're able to set aside the future and your worry about what might be. And I wonder if you are able to do that, if you're able to set aside set aside the worry about the future, could you hear that small voice of now? That message traveling throughout your body that you are satisfied. That message giving you hope and life and making you feel loved and cared for. Do you think you could hear it if you could set aside all is well? All that you're worrying about, and just be here. Right here at Good Samaritan Church, surrounded by all these people right now, here in this moment. In just a bit, we are going to turn in our pledges to the church, and we will watch others do so as well. This is not a time for fear about whether it will be enough. And this is not a time for grieving that is not as much as it perhaps once was. This is a time for the peace of wild things. This is a time for celebration and for gratitude. This is a pause that is hopefully long enough to realize that we are full. That we are receiving gifts of life and love that will sustain us. Unique and wonderful gifts of them. And And just a little while ago, we received all these new members into our lives. And as we do that, this is not a time to grieve all the ways that these new members are not like some of the former members of this church. This is not a time to worry that they're becoming part of us when we change. And this is not a time for those new members who joined us today to worry that we will change them. Oh no, we're going to ask them to be on committees, pledge, and to engage fully in this congregation. No, this is a time for the peace of wild things. This, right now, is a time of celebration and incredible gratitude. This is a time to pause long enough to realize that we are full, that we are receiving the gifts of life and the gifts of love, and that these gifts will sustain us. These unique and wonderful gifts we join our presence today. If you have ever wondered why there is so much ritual in church, why do we have folks who have already in many ways become a part of our community come and stand up here in front? Why don't we just put our pledge cards in the mail instead of bringing them to church and dropping them in a basket? Well, it's to give us those moments we need for pause. It's to give us those moments we need for that message to travel to our hearts and to our bodies and to our heads. Something new and something wonderful is happening right now, right here in our midst. That we are receiving, that we are taking in, that we are soaking up something life-giving right now. Rituals, they acknowledge the grace of the world, the grace of the God who cares for us. So may all of our lives be full of ritual and full of pause. May our weeks heading into Thanksgiving be full of awareness and gratitude. And may we enter the peace of wild things and bathe in the grace of what we are receiving right here, right now, each and every moment, and always give thanks.